I hate to say practice, but you know it is. It is what it is. But God's got something good in store for us this morning. I promise you that. Okay, guys, I'm going to open us up in a word of prayer, and then the band's going to kick us off. They're going to give us once again. They're going to give us an opportunity. Okay, and hear me when I say that. They're going to give us an opportunity to worship. Okay, let's take advantage of that. Let's take advantage of that. Whether we're in this building, whether we're in our homes, whether we're driving in our cars, no matter where we're at, let's take advantage of the opportunity that God has given us today. Amen? All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for the day. Lord, thank you for a new day. Lord, for an opportunity to get up this morning and God, to come together, to fellowship together. Lord, no matter whether we're here, whether we're online, Lord, no matter where we're at, we thank you for this ability to worship together this morning. Father, we pray, Lord, for this service. God, we ask that everything that takes place here, Lord, that it honors you, that it glorifies you. Father, I pray, Lord, specifically that if there's someone that's here, someone that's watching this that doesn't have a relationship with you, then Father, I'm going to pray, God, that your Holy Spirit would just speak to their hearts. And Lord, that before they leave here, before we get done, God, that they would know that they need that relationship with you. Father, we continue to pray for our country. Lord, we continue to pray for your peace, Lord, to just overcome all the chaos that's going on. Father, we pray for your divine intervention, Lord, with this virus. God, my prayer is not going to change, Lord. I'm just going to continue to pray that you wipe it off the face of this earth. And Lord, we're going to stand up boldly. And Father, we're going to proclaim your name. Lord, we're going to proclaim your truth. Lord, we're going to proclaim your grace that you have given to each and every one of us as a free gift, Lord, if we would only choose to accept it. Father, we just pray, Lord, that our worship is pleasing to you this morning. Jesus, bless this time together. It's in your most precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Save your life. Thank you. Will y'all pray with me? Lord, help us to believe. Thank you for all that you do for us. Thank you for everyone that's here today, whether they're watching or listening or here in person or here in spirit. I pray that you would just teach us all something today, and you would open our hearts to be receptive. In your Son's precious name, amen.
Hey, man, we don't brag on them enough. We really don't. And these guys and ladies, I've told you all this before, but I've got to tell you again, you know, through everything that has taken place, man, they never wavered. Never wavered, never backed up, never said, oh, man, we can't do that. It's always been, you know, you bet, whatever we need to do. And all of y'all, man, thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart, because, man, we couldn't have done what God has allowed us to do if y'all hadn't. Because people wouldn't come to hear me preach for an hour. I know that, all right? As much as I want to tell myself you would, I know you wouldn't, but that's okay. That's okay. I'm all about whatever it takes to get you here. That's what's important for me. And then we can get you the word. All right. We've got a lot of ground to cover today. Okay. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm going to try not to go fast. That was one thing I learned from doing this morning. Is there so much information within this message this morning that it may seem like we're, and I'm going to try to go slow. I really, really am. But guys, I'm just going to tell you, there is so much information, so many different challenges that we're given through the text that we're going to be looking at this morning. That it's one of those things that man, we need to get this. Folks, we do. We need to get this as the church. And here's the other side of this, because we lose sight sometimes that within this letter, within Colossians, specifically, you know, Paul's addressing the church. Okay, he's addressing Christians, and we need to be mindful of that. As far as who the audience was, because in essence, we're the audience. Okay, we are the audience that this is addressed to, and we need to get it. We really need to get it. And when I say get it, guys, I mean we need to get it. Okay, now so far through, you know, the last couple of weeks, we've looked at a lot of different things, and we have covered a lot of ground. You know, we've looked at the, you know, we've been challenged to, you should remember it from the text, to set our sights on heaven, okay? To set our sights on the reality of what's above us, okay? Of what's waiting for us. We've been challenged to think about the things of heaven, okay? Remember, we've talked about what you think about the most is what you're going to value the most. We've been challenged through the word to think about heaven, to think about the things of heaven. You know, when we're thinking about the things of heaven, guys, I'm going to tell you, it makes all this other stuff almost seem irrelevant, if you would. We've been reminded that we've died to this life. Now, we know that's that can be some hard language or whatever it may be, but we have died to this life. We've died to that old life that we were living before we came into that relationship with Jesus Christ. We've been challenged to put to death, remember this, to put to death the sinful earthly things, remember this, lurking around. Okay, to put to death those things, get rid of, remember last week, anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. We've been challenged to remember that through Christ, it doesn't matter whether we're a Jew or a Gentile, okay? Because God has closed that gap. This morning, we're going to look at some virtues. Okay, and I know that can be a big word for you at sometimes, but we're gonna look at some virtues that stand in the complete opposition, if you would, to all these vices that we've looked at the previous couple of weeks. Okay, we're gonna look at these virtues. We're gonna look at these, let's call it characteristics, that as a Christian that we need to have. Okay, that need to define who we are, if you would. In other words, we've looked at a whole bunch of don'ts. Okay? Now, some of you I know, your entire life growing up, your mama, your daddy, somebody had to tell you, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this, don't touch that stove. You've been told don't your whole entire life, and you're tired of being told don't, okay? All right, good news is the word's going to tell us this morning, okay, you need to do this. Now, some of you don't like being told what to do either, but you're going to have to get over yourself here, okay? Because I'm telling you, if you want to be successful in this life, and I'm not talking financial or anything like that, guys. I'm talking about being able to enjoy this life that God has given us, okay, even throughout the crazy times, then there's virtues in here. There's characteristics that we have to, guys, these characteristics have to define us. They must. Now, you know, Paul's going to use a word in this before we get into the text. He's going to use a terminology. He's going to use a phrase, and that phrase is going to be to clothe yourself. Okay, to clothe yourself with all of these. Now, you know, I'm not one, Tracy. I do not like going and shopping for clothes. Okay, that's not in my DNA. Corey, you don't either, do you? I do not like going and shopping for clothes. I just don't. I'm not going to try. 99.9% of the time, if I'm buying a pair, I'm probably not even going to try them home. Try them on. I'm going to wait till I get home, and if they fit, great. If they don't, well, I just lost money, okay? I don't like doing it. Now, I like when Tracy gets me a new shirt, okay? Man, I do. I enjoy that. I enjoy being able to have a new shirt, okay? It's kind of nice, you know? And she's going to pick out something a whole lot better than anything that I would ever pick out, okay? Well, guys, as we look at this, you know, I'm going to tell you right now, when we take these virtues, when we take these characteristics and we clothe ourselves with them, folks, I'm going to tell you right now, it has a way of making you feel so much better, okay? Trust me on that. If you've never clothed yourself with these, you're fixing to be challenged here this morning. Our text this morning is Colossians 3. Now, we're having all kinds of, oh, you got it going, Gene, yeah! He got it going, man. Ronnie got it going? Oh, Gene, oh, it's not. Oh, not on it. Okay. You guys online, I'm sorry, you're not going to be able to see it. But you people in here, if you don't have your Bible, it's going to be up on the screens. Technical difficulties this morning. Satan's not going to win. He can get out of here. So anyways, here we go. Colossians 3, verses 12 through 15 is where we're going to be this morning. Check this out. Beginning in verse 12, it says, Since God chose you. Now, we could stop right there, this whole message could be over that. But anyway, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tenderhearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you're called to live in peace and always be thankful. Y'all pray with me. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. God, and Father, I know that, man, I don't need to say anything else. Because, Lord, your word says enough. And God, Lord, I'm going to ask right now, Lord, that any of us that are in here, any of us that are watching this or listening to this, God, I'm going to pray that whatever it is that we're bound up with, maybe whatever it is we're struggling with, as we look at these virtues, Lord, as we look at these characteristics that need to define who we are, Father, that if we're struggling with one, if we're struggling with two, Lord, if we're struggling with all of them. God, so many times I don't like praying for conviction, but God, if we need to be convicted, then Father, I'm going to pray that conviction will, Lord, that it'll show us where we're struggling, and God, wherever that struggle is, whatever that sin is, Lord, that your conviction will just root it out. Lord, once again, I thank you for everyone that's here this morning. I thank you for everyone that's tuning in, Lord, no matter where they may be. Father, help us open up our hearts this morning. Open up our ears and allow us to hear from you. Jesus, I pray for your words. Jesus, I pray that it's not my message, that it's not my words, but Father, that it all comes directly from you. Father, bless this time together. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Guys, as we, you know, as we look at these, as we look at these virtues, as we look at these characteristics, it's pretty simple to see, and it's pretty easy to see that they all stand in complete opposition, if you would, to everything we have read, studied, and looked at up to this point. I mean, that's pretty self-explanatory when you get in there and when you start seeing that and reading that and allowing those virtues, if you would, to speak to you and show you that, okay? Now it also should be apparent to us, which means, guys, it needs to stand out to us as we read these, as you know, and we're going to dive in a little bit deeper into each one of them here in a second. But it's one of those things that it should stand out to us that these have to do with a personal relationships between mankind, okay? Between individuals, between a church body, okay? Between, you know, between Scott and myself. These need to be characteristics that we share and that we share together, but also that we demonstrate to one another, okay? Now, at no point in this whole thing, that fly's going to drive me crazy, at no point in this whole thing have I said anything, or have I even hinted at, you know, the slightest little bit that all of this would be easy, okay? Because, guys, it's not. It's not, and you're going to see that. Hopefully, you're going to see that as we get into this. Now, you know, at no point, here's the other thing with this letter, and here's where I go back and I reemphasize who this letter was to. At no point has Paul divulged or has Paul said, hey, this is the problem that this particular church is facing. Paul has not said that. Okay, we don't know that, we don't get that, or whatever. So the reality of that is guys, is that we need to understand that this is for us. Okay, you understand that? This is for you. This was intended when God gave it to him. Not only was it intended for that church, but it was intended for you today. It was intended for me today. It was intended that I read it, that I hear it, and that I apply it today. You know, he could have been addressing a problem, but better yet, guys, better yet, he's encouraging them on these characteristics to help them and encourage them as far as to make their circumstances that they were involved in to be better. Now the key to this, there's a couple of keys in this. One of the main keys that we're going to focus on today is that very last characteristic that he gave us, that word patience, okay? Now hang on to it, because we're going to come back to it here and we're going to spend a little bit of time on it. You know, the content, guys, I'm going to tell you right now, the ability to master this, it comes back to patience. You know, and we're from the standpoint, from a worldly standpoint, most of us, we're not very patient people, are we? You know, we live in an instant gratification world, don't we? Okay? You know, some of you, and it shows, you never had to search through an encyclopedia to get information, did you? Some of you don't even know what an encyclopedia is, okay? You know, our only saving grace with encyclopedias was the fact that they were alphabetized, okay? And so you kind of knew which one to get into on whatever topic you were looking at. You know, now you, man, if you want to find out something, what do? You Google it. You Google it, you type it in Google, and man, it gives you 3 million different possibilities on different searches and anything. Man, if we'd have had that when I was a kid, I'd have been an A student. I promise you, man. You know, I'm telling you, it wasn't just about having the odd answers in the back of the book. Now you could get them all. We only had the odd answers. But anyways, instant gratification. You don't have to leave your house to do anything, do you? You guys, you can get on your phone, you can have food delivered to your house, can't you? Okay? You can get on your, man, if you want to order groceries. Okay, you know, you can order groceries online, and you know, there's places that they can be delivered to you. You know, you can shop on Amazon, and you can put something in, and you know, they're getting their delivery times back, but you could literally have it the next day. Okay, instant gratification is where we're at. You know, patience is almost like it's a lost art. Okay, so now stay with me on that, because we're going to come back to this. Because the focal point of this deals with tension. Specifically, deals with tension between two individuals, if you would. Or three individuals. Or multiple individuals. Now it starts to get a little personal, doesn't it? Because we've all experienced tension with other people. Okay? Now the problem with that is, when we experience that tension, our focus is on that other individual that's causing us the heartburn and stuff. Whereas what Paul is telling us here, instead of focusing on that individual, maybe we need to shift our focus and focus back on ourselves, okay? That's where patience is going to come in, and we'll come back with it. Now, I've already talked about, you know, we've already talked about the last couple of weeks, these don'ts, non-negotiable. Everybody remember that. Just as the don'ts were non-negotiable, the do's are non-negotiable as well, okay? Now, it's important that we start, that we look at where Paul started with this. When you go back to verse 12, where he started in verse 12, go back and look at it. It says, since God chose you, okay? Yeah, your translation may say chosen, okay? But since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves. Guys, I want you to focus on that word chose, okay? Or chosen, depending on whatever it is that you're reading. You know, this is important terminology for us to get, for us to gather. Because the original audience, as Paul is delivering this letter to them, the original audience had grown up. They had been raised in an era where you use the word chose or chosen. It was the Jewish people always referred to as what? God's chosen people. God's chosen people. Okay? And don't sit there and think that they didn't, man, you know, puff their chest out. Yeah, we're God's chosen people. I guarantee you they did, and rightfully so. Rightfully so. You know, we'll give them that. But what Paul is reminding the Colossians here, what he is reminding us today, that same terminology, just as God had designated the Jews as his chosen people, folks, guess what? You need to understand, and I need to understand, that we are chosen just like they were. You are a part, as a Christian, okay, as a believer in Christ, as someone who has a relationship with Jesus, you are a part of God's chosen people, okay? You are chosen. Now, maybe when you're in school, I don't know, maybe you always got picked last to play Red Rover, but today you are chosen. You understand that? You're at the head of the class. You're at the front of the line. None of that other stuff defines you. God has chosen you. Same terminology. As Paul ministered to those Gentiles, guys, it was imperative. It was important that they understood that. They were no longer they weren't second-class citizens, okay? You understand that? They weren't another race of people that, you know, well, man, hey, you can't be up here at the front of the line or whatever it may be. They were chosen by God. That applies to us today. Now, in that first section there that we read, there's five traits that Paul lists. The New Living Translation says tender-hearted mercy. Number two, kindness. Number three, humility. Number four, gentleness. And number five, patience. Now, when we look at tender-hearted mercy, guys, the thing that we can translate that down to, I think that all of us can understand today, is compassion. Is having compassion. Now, but before we get too far, here's the other thing. Each of those five traits. Here's the kicker with them. You choose whether or not you're going to exhibit them. Okay? You understand that? You make that choice to be compassionate. You make that choice whether or not you're going to have compassion on another human being. Whether or not you're going to have compassion over someone who's suffering. Whether you're going to have compassion over someone who's going through a hard time. Whether or not you're going to have compassion over someone who's different than you. Who looks different, maybe who thinks different than you. All of these are choices that we make. Now, kindness, that second one, guys, they all are no-brainers, and they all should stand out to us. But, guys, kindness should be a given. You know, as a Christian, you need to be a kind person, okay? It should be a given. It's a result of having a tender heart. Now, I know a lot of people don't believe this about me, but I'm going to tell you right now, man, I've got a tender heart. Now, I know there's times that I have a hard time showing that. And I probably know my son growing up, he probably didn't think I had a very tender heart. But guys, I promise you, man, I have had a tender heart. I'm not even going to look. She probably says, no, he don't. Yes, I do. Okay? I have had a tender heart for the majority of my life, and I believe my heart is still tender. Now, I ain't going to lie to you. There's been times that it's been hardened, okay, to certain situations and stuff like that. But having that kindness, guys, it's a result of that tender heart. You know, showing kindness to another human being, okay? Showing kindness to another human being, guys, that should be the hallmark of Christianity. That should be the hallmark of our lives and how we exhibit our lives, if you would. You know, and all we got to do Study the life of Jesus. Study the life of Jesus. See who he hung out with. See who he ministered to. You know, we had a couple of messages about that not too terribly long ago. Who did Jesus hang out with? Guys, he hung out with the people that nobody else wanted to hang out with, didn't he? Think about that. Remember the tax collectors? Jesus hung out with the tax collectors. Nobody else liked them people. We still don't like tax collectors today. Nobody wanted, but Jesus showed them kindness. What about the lepers? What about the ones that if you went and touched them, you could get sick? And get some of that funk on you. You understand what I'm saying there? You know, what did Jesus do? Jesus went to those people. And what did he do? Man, he healed them. He showed them kindness. He loved on them. He showed them kindness. He spent more time with those people than anyone else. Okay, other than his disciples, he spent more time with those people than anyone else. So what does that tell us as far as one of the characteristics of our life? Guys, if we're just hanging out with people who are just like us, okay, if we hang out with people who all I hang out with is people who are identical to me, then guys, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm really not showing the world how to be kind. I'm really not showing the kindness of Jesus Christ, all right? It wasn't too long. You know, like I said, well, I've already said that. It wasn't too long. We need to be kind. That third trait, humility. Now, this is my favorite one. This is my favorite one. And I think a lot of people struggle with this one, man. I really do. You know, this last week I read Proverbs 27:2 on one of our online videos one night. Proverbs 27:2. I don't have it back there, Gene, but it says, "Let someone else praise you, not your own mouth, a stranger, not your own lips." Guys, when we think about humility, when we break that down to simply being humble, all right, being humble is being free from pride. It's being free from pride, and it's being free from self-glorification, okay? Because it's being free from saying, hey, I'm not going to pat myself on the back, okay? It's being free from not, you know, hey, man, look at me, look at what I've done. All right. Now, everybody in here, except for some of these young ones, y'all know the Mac Davis song, don't you? Huh? Come on now. How's it go? Oh, Lord, it's what? When you're perfect in every way. Wesley Wabbit, you know. Oh, Lord, it's hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way. Okay? You know, Mac, anyways. Here's the thing. If we think that people truly don't, there are people out there that truly believe that about themselves. Okay. Now I'm not gonna lie to you. There's some people out there that are absolutely amazing. Some of y'all in here are some of the most amazing people I've ever met in my life. Okay. There, I'll give you that. Some of you are also some of the biggest turds I ever met in my life. I'll give you that too. Okay. But think about it. Think about it from this standpoint. You know, guys, if you're living your life right now and you're sitting there and you're thinking, man, I just can't be humble because man, I'm just too dang good. You know, take some advice from Mac Davis and go get yourself another mirror, okay? You know, come look in my mirror, and I promise if I look in there with you, I can point some stuff out. You understand? Humility. As Christians, we need to be humble. We need to have that sense of humility and realize and know, this is not about me. It's not about you, okay? You know, another way to, you know, let me go on because for time's sake, let me go on here, okay? Gentleness. Now, I always think of a newborn baby, okay? When you think about gentleness, you guys know how I love babies. When you hold a baby, do you squeeze it for all it's worth? No, you cradle it, don't you? You put it in your arms, and man, maybe swaddle is a better word, but you cradle it. You're gentle with it. You support that child's head. You don't want their head to fall down. You don't want, I mean, it's precious, isn't it? The way you just hang on to that precious little baby. Guys, gentleness in how we deal with other people, in how we deal with somebody that's going through a hard time. We've got to be careful with it. We've got to nurture it. You know, gentleness is also one of those deals. You talk about, we can word it as far as power. Think about this, power under control. You know, when you're holding that little baby that has no power to do anything on their own other than maybe, you know, suck on a bottle, cry, pee and poop, and that's all that baby can do. You know, you have all the power right there. Imagine when you're out there horseback and you're sitting on the back of that horse. You know, you think about all the horsepower underneath that saddle. Is that horse stronger than you? You bet your bottom dollar it is. How are you controlling it? Maybe with your legs, maybe with your feet, and a set of reins and a bit, or it's whatever it may be. But guys, that is power under control. That is gentleness. All right, you know, guys, we've got to understand that being gentle with people who are struggling, guys, is a key trait of Christianity. Now here's that one big one: patience. You see, so often we all, and where I went with it earlier, we often look at patience as our ability or inability, however you want to define it, to wait on something. Okay? And there's merit to that. But here's the other side of it. All right, from the biblical perspective of this, guys, there's more to patience than simply waiting on something. Okay? Patience, as it's given to us here in verse 12, you know, it serves as the springboard, if you would, going into verse 13 of how it enables us to deal with all these other things that are getting thrown at us. Having patience allows us to endure. Now, guys, I'm telling you, this part of this message has never been more relevant for me than it is right now. But patience allows us to endure a hard time. Patience allows us to endure a pandemic. All right, you understand what I'm saying? Patience allows us to endure and overcome all the craziness that's going on out there in the world. But, you know, we can get it a little bit more personal, too. Patience allows us to endure being wronged. All right? Patience allows us to overcome that stuff. Patience endures wrongs. Man, it bears injustices. It affords us the ability, and here's another key part with it. Having patience affords you, and it affords me, the ability to not seek revenge, okay? To not seek, if you want to call it self-gratification or whatever it may be, retaliation. You know, guys, it affords us the ability to do that. Now, patience, here's the other side of it. It's easy to point out other people's faults. All right, you agree with that? I mean, you know, you see somebody going whatever they may be going through. I can point out their faults all day long through somebody else. You know, when I'm doing that, what am I doing? Man, I'm simply overlooking the own faults in my own life, aren't I? All right? Guys, we've got to be careful with that. You know, patience here, you know, we have these five traits that he's given us here, okay? You know, without that tender heart, you know, without kindness, without gentleness, without humility, and without patience, there's no way we can adhere to what comes next. There's no way we can continue to clothe ourselves the way God is asking us to clothe ourselves here. You know, and we talk about people and their shortcomings. You know, guys, I've been in the ministry long enough that man, goodness gracious. You know, I've learned that there are people who thrive in chaos. Okay? There are people that, man, I tell you what, they're not happy unless there is chaos taking place. You know, there's also people, and guys, this is just within the church. Understand what I'm saying? I'm not saying anybody here, so don't take that. It's one of those deals, Joel, where you can't look at anybody, all right? You know, there's also people, and especially on this one, there's also people that, you know, they thrive by their ability to stir the pot. You understand? Some of you know who I'm talking about. If you've been in the ministry at all, you know. Well, so-and-so said. Preacher, your message was a little bit long. Well, you know, didn't you preach that? They love to stir the pot. All right, that's what they love to do. That's what makes them happier than anything else in the world. You know, and then there's some people that they thrive by being the, here's a big religious word for you, by being the religious zealot. Okay, the religious person that is so good, that person that, man, they want you to know how good they are. They want you to know that, man, they are so close to God that, man, God, the Holy Spirit's just pouring off of them, all right? You've been around some of these people before, you know, and then there's people that thrive by simply having a crisis. They're not happy, they're not good unless there is a crisis in their life, whether it's a real crisis or whether it's one they just made up, okay? People come in all different shapes, forms, all different kinds of personalities, and you know the key to this is learning and having the ability to deal and handle every one of them. Without those five traits, folks, we can't be the church that God has called us to be. And I'm not talking a little C church, I'm talking big C church. All right, we can't function the way we're supposed to. You know, reality is, guys, we all know different people who fit into those categories. Some of them might have hurt you. Some of them might have hurt you at some point. Some of them might have, they might have betrayed you. And guys, that's where patience comes in. Because we've got to have patience if we're going to be willing to have, or if we're going to have the ability to forgive them. To forgive them. Now that's the one. That's the one that gets us so many times. You know, have you ever had anybody in your life that for whatever reason you just did not want to forgive them? Oh, I have. You know, God, are you sure? You sure you want me to forgive that dude? You sure? Do you really know what they did, God? God, do you really know what they said? God, do you really? God, I don't think you know how they hurt me. God, I don't. Man, you know, I'm your child. I'm your servant. I don't think you know how bad they were talking about me. You sure you want me to forgive him? Why don't you know, God? You don't think you could just take them out? And we'll just tell everybody they left. You know. Man, I've been there. But guys, that's not a trait that God has called. That's not what he's called us. That's not how he's called us to live. He's called us to live with these traits and apply these traits to our lives so that the world, and I am out of time. I'm sorry on the radio. Y'all stay with me here. Facebook, stay with me. We're gonna keep rolling here. We're going to keep rolling here, and I'm going to find a stopping point with this, all right? Patience comes, that's where we learn to forgive. And guys, oh man, it's not a suggestion, because his word tells us there, you must forgive. You must forgive. Without patience and without that final article of clothing that we're not going to talk about today, we're going to move it into next week. Guys, without that patience and without that love, there's no way that we can be the church and be the Christian that God has called us to be, okay? Those five traits, those five characteristics, we've all got areas to work on, okay? I raised my hand up as number one as being, you know, there's lots of areas that I've still got to work on, because there's lots, sometimes, you know, I sit here and tell you I'm tender-hearted, and there's sometimes that I am hard-hearted. Guys, there's sometimes that, you know, man, I like to think I'm gentle. You know, I like to think I have those kid gloves on, but I also know there's times that where I have not been gentle. You know, there's lots of times where, good Lord knows, that's why I don't like going clothes shopping, because I don't have no patience, okay? I don't have no patience. Those are all traits that each and every one of us, no matter what we're dealing with, no matter where we're going, that we all have an area there that we need to work on. My question for you here today is, which one is it for you? Folks, I don't want to be known. I don't want to be known as that church body. I don't want to be known as that preacher. I don't want to be known as that Christian that has no compassion for someone that's hurting. I don't want to be known as that preacher. I don't want to be known as that pastor. I don't want to be known as that church, as the church that will not help somebody that's going through a hard time. I want to be that church. I want us to be that church. I want to be that pastor that people know that, you know what, them people out there, they're doing it exactly the way Jesus did it. And folks, when we do it exactly the way Jesus did it, man, I'm going to tell you right now, in our personal lives, not only in our personal lives, but as a church body as well, there is nothing better on this earth that we could ever experience. Which one of those traits are you struggling with? Which one in your life needs some work? Is it patience? Is it kindness? Is it gentleness? Maybe it's humility. Maybe it's humility. Allow God. Allow the Holy Spirit. Allow Him. If it's conviction convicting you, then guys, I'm going to challenge you right now. Before you leave here, get it right. Get it right. And just see what God does with you this week. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we're going to give you that chance right now. We're going to give you that opportunity. All right? I knew I had way too much here this morning. I knew that. And that's okay. That's okay. Because we've got at least one more, possibly two more weeks with this. All right? That's okay. It's all about God's plan, not mine. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we're going to give you that opportunity. Don't leave here. Don't leave here without knowing Him. You know, the last song that they sang a while ago, the very opening line that Emily sang jumped out to me. Talking about hearing those voices in your head that tell you, you are not enough. Well, guys, I'm going to tell you something. There was a man by the name of Jesus who was enough. And as a result of Him being enough, He makes you worthy. He makes you worthy. Tell that voice to shut up. Sorry, parents. Tell that voice to shut up. And you listen to the one true voice. He's not going to come to you in anger, but He's speaking to you in kindness, humility, gentleness. And folks, He's been patient long enough. Long enough. Now's your time to respond. Y'all stand with me and let's pray. Father, we thank You once again for this day. Lord, I thank You for this opportunity to be able to gather up here this morning. And Jesus, I pray, God, that, Lord, I know there's things in my life that I've got to work on. So, Father, Lord, this week and moving into next week, and Lord, whatever it is in my life that needs to be worked on, and God, You've made it evident. But Father, as I pray this prayer, and I pray this prayer over each and every one that's here, each and every one that's watching, God, whatever trait it is that we need to work on, Lord, make that evident to all of us this week. Lord, give us the courage. Lord, give us the humbleness, God, to confess that to You. Father, give us the boldness to say, I can't do this on my own. Father, give us those traits. Lord, we pray that those traits are magnified in our lives, not because of us, but because of what You have done with us. And Father, right now, I pray that if there is somebody watching, somebody in here that doesn't know You, God, I pray, Father, that You would speak to their hearts right now, and Lord, that they would realize and they would know that today is the day of salvation for them. Father, give them the courage to look. And folks, if that's you in here right now, if that's you watching right now, I want you to hear this, because this is not some, it's not some magic prayer. It's not something that you can just do this and say, okay, man, hey, I asked Jesus into my heart, man, I'm good. No, because folks, I'm going to tell you right now, if you pray this prayer, if you pray and ask Jesus into your heart, you need to understand that there has to be a repentance in your life. And repentance means that you turn from what you're doing. Whatever vice you're hung up with, that repentance means that you get rid of that vice and you live your life according to God. So if you're serious about that and if you're ready for that freedom that can only come from Christ, then I ask you to pray this prayer with me. Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Jesus, I know You died on that cross for my sins. Jesus, I ask You to come into my heart. Jesus, I ask You to forgive me. Jesus, I ask You to save me. Father, if they had the courage and the boldness there to call out to You, Lord, I pray You give them the courage. Lord, if they saw it online, Lord, they got to witness baptisms last week. Lord, they got to witness baptisms, Lord, midweek here. And Father, I pray, God, that they would have the, Lord, the courage to come forward and be obedient, Lord, not to me or any man, but God, that they would be obedient to You and follow through with that believer's baptism. God, thank You for giving us this opportunity today. Thank You for letting us open up Your word. Jesus, we give You the praise. We give You all the glory. It's in Your name we pray. Amen. Guys, thank y'all for being here. Thank y'all for tuning in. Lindsay, you got a birthday today? Happy birthday. What are you, 23? Yep. Now, what are you, 43? 34. Well, happy birthday. All right. God bless you guys.